On October 29th, 1976, if you were alive and being raised by television, there's no question that in the evening, as you snacked on canned chocolate pudding and devil dogs, instead of watching your usual Sanford and Son, Sonny and Cher, Rockford Files, or Quincy M.E., you smacked your sibling's hand away from the dial and turned it to ABC because you needed to watch this bit of television history.
The Paul Lynn Halloween Special!
Which included these amazing people. And as much as we love Florence Henderson, she's kind of awful here.
That old black magic got you beat so well.
And the television debut of Kiss, performing no less than three songs. If you survived the entire hour without turning off your TV, and I know you did, as your family, long gone, played toss across in the next room, you were fully prepped for the purported Halloween fun that was scheduled to follow. The ABC Friday night movie, Look What's Happened to Rosemary's Baby. Now, in the roster of made-for-TV movies, this is surely a contender for worst title ever, even among other made-for-TV movie titles like The Feminist and the Fuzz, Smile, Jenny, You're Dead, Having Babies 2, and Pray for the Wildcats. First of all, TV movie titles, don't tell us what to do. And don't borrow so hard from another movie title that you would completely confuse us so that we are continually calling you Whatever Happened to Rosemary's Baby, as I always, always, always do. But the title problem is even worse than that, which is where we will land by the end of this presentation. This movie is, of course, the film sequel to the 1968 Roman Polanski movie, Rosemary's Baby, which was based on the book by Ira Levin. The movie was a huge hit, so I suppose it was inevitable that people would want to know what became of the titular baby. It should be mentioned that Ira Levin wrote a novel, Son of Rosemary, as a sequel to his own book, but that was not written until 1997. So Levin's sequel has absolutely nothing to do with this movie, which is probably a good thing since that book includes an incestuous attraction between Rosemary and her full-grown son, and the fact that everything in the original story and the book sequel did not actually ever take place because it was all a dream. That's right, just like in Newhart and Dallas, none of it actually ever happened. Which is, I suppose, why nobody's ever bothered to make a film out of that book. Look What's Happened was directed by Sam Osteen, who was not only the amazing editor for Polanski's Rosemary's Baby, but was editor for Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf, Cool Hand Luke, The Graduate, and Chinatown. He also directed Sparkle, The Best Little Girl in the World, and Queen of the Stardust Ballroom, all of which were critically acclaimed. The movie also used cinematographer John A. Alonzo, whose work includes Chinatown and Scarface. Which makes this movie a real head-scratcher because, as it turns out, this movie is absolutely terrible. Possibly to blame, probably to blame, is writer Anthony Wilson. He had created the television series version of Planet of the Apes, which is pretty cool, as well as Future Cop, one of five television series to feature an android police officer, but the only one to star Ernest Borgnine.
I know.
The first act of Look What's Happened covers the childhood of Rosemary and Satan's kid, known to his mother as Andrew and to the coven as Adrian. Rosemary tries to escape the grip of the coven by running away with him. As we meet the cast, we see it is mostly stellar, although they're not exactly executing their talents at their peak. So we see Ruth Gordon reprising the role of Minnie that won her the Oscar.
The new Subaru brat.
Just tell him it's good looking.
Replacing Sidney Blackmer in the role of Roman Castevet is Oscar winner Ray Milland, famous for such classics as The Lost Weekend and Dial M for Murder, but who helped pioneer the unfortunate 1970s trend of sophisticated acting legends scraping barrel bottoms for work when, in the year 1972, he gave us this historic double whammy. In this film, he literally dies of frogs. And...
does it talk?
Sure he does.
Don't touch me!
All of that paving the way for movies like this. And if you know the actors Ruth Gordon and Ray Milland, I'm sure you can already just imagine the chemistry between them.
Ah, will you lay off?
Minnie, please.
What do you want from my life?
Shut up!
And we have Oscar winner Patty Duke replacing Mia Farrow to play Rosemary. Now, there were some genuinely scary made-for-TV horror movies in the 70s, for sure, but this is not one of them. But don't blame Patty Duke for that. She does her darndest to try to convince you that what you're watching on your TV screen is, in fact, horrifyingly scary.
Oh my God! No!
Nobody's driving the bus. We never learn what happens to her on that bus. It just drives off and she's never seen again. It could still be out there driving, for all we know. The film isn't called Look What's Happened to Rosemary, so who are we to complain? Believe it or not, this movie actually includes 4 Oscar-winning actors, but Broderick Crawford's appearance as the sheriff is so brief, he will never, ever be remembered for this movie. For sure. So good for him.
And if they don't deliver, give me the hammer and I'll do it myself.
Young Adrian / Andrew is played by Philip Boyer, who, unlike his co-stars, will never win an Oscar because his acting career didn't last more than 2 years after the broadcast of this movie. Perhaps the reason he was never hired to do much of anything after this is because he cannot stop looking at the camera. This movie offers a glimpse of how Adrian was raised by the coven. We see black eggs for Easter. We see his bedroom decorations. These things are hanging from the ceiling. There's sort of an upside-down Chucky doll with something in its armpit, a baby-sized Nazi helmet, and a teddy that incinerates itself rather than remain in a movie with these satanic assholes. There's a nice shot here of Adrian's bedroom, which reveals Nazi flags on the walls, and a Hugo Man of 1,000 Faces doll. Yes, the scariest fucking doll ever made in the history of dolls. Of course, this movie would have been a few notches scarier if the filmmakers had made better use of the Hugo doll and the mini Nazi helmet. Here we see little Adrian using his satanic superpowers to knock other kids onto their butts. We'll see later he's a bit more skilled at this as an adult, as he goes up against members of the 4-H Club. In this first part of the movie, we also see Tina Louise playing a hooker named Margene, who raises Adrian under the influence of the coven after Rosemary's bus snapping. Don't forget, Louise had been really great in The Stepford Wives, also based on a book by Ira Levin. And at this point in her career, is understandably skipping any and all Gilligan's Island reunion movies, of which there were several. And replacing John Cassavetes as Guy Woodhouse, we have George Maharis and his terrible hairpiece. Guy is watched over and guided throughout this movie by a mostly silent character named Lakin. And if I'm interpreting things correctly, it's implied that he is a demon incarnate, which is a neat concept. He's played by Lloyd Haynes, who had led the cast of the Emmy Award-winning James L. Brooks dramedy Room 222, playing a teacher doling out life lessons to his students. So this role was probably a fun flipping of character for him.
Somebody's got to do something before somehow he finds his way here.
It's too late. He's already here.
So let's meet adult Adrian, played by Stephen McHattie's pursed lips. McHattie's only other significant role before this was playing James Dean in a made-for-TV biopic. Despite this movie, McHattie has now amassed more than 200 film and TV credits, including famously being Elaine's psychiatrist on Seinfeld, and he's still working. So Adrian ends up being raised in a desert casino by Margene, who runs the place. He's grown up to be a local rock star, leading the house band at the casino. He's about to have a birthday, reaching the same age Jesus reached when he, according to this movie, received his powers. And so godparents Minnie and Roman and a gaggle of witchy strangers arrive to perform a ceremony that will somehow make official Adrian's antichristness.
Drink.
Poor Adrian gets drugged twice in this movie. The first drugging is courtesy of Minnie. And here we can see how Ruth Gordon's Oscar-winning performance transfers to the small screen. Now that he's nice and drugged up, they perform, against his will, a ritual so sinister, so cruel and evil, that it is hard for us in the 21st century to wrap our minds around how anyone could write such a heinous act into an ABC Friday night movie script. They turn him into a mime. Which seems nonsensical to us now, but back in the 70s, mimes were a thing. Mimes were everywhere. And actually, mimes were even countercultural in rock and roll. You had Shields and Yarnell, Moominchants, the movie Shanks, produced by William Castle, who produced the original Rosemary's Baby. David Bowie was trained by a mime, and that same mime made Kate Bush Kate Bush. And even Jesus Christ himself dabbled in the 70s. Now, despite a lot of chanting, mime Adrian was somehow able to resist being fully transformed into the true Antichrist.
It didn't take.
But in his drugged up stupor, is lured by the sounds of rock and roll debauchery taking place in the casino's nightclub. There he battles the forces of darkness on stage in what must surely be film and television's goofiest possession sequence ever. By the end of the scene, Guy electrocutes Adrian's best friend, Peter Simon, who is a stand-in for a Jesus apostle. Peter Simon was played by Stephen McHattie's real-life friend, actor David Huffman. His promising career was sadly cut short in 1985 when he was stabbed to death as he tried to helpfully intervene after a robbery had taken place. In the third act, we find Andrew is locked up in an asylum for the criminally insane. We are introduced to Nurse Ellen, played by Donna Mills. This was long before Knots Landing. After some flirting and plot twists, we find that Ellen is Andrew's Guy Woodhouse. She's in with the coven, and she needs to put Andrew through the same ritual as Rosemary so that yet another spawn of Satan can take a crack at being the Antichrist. When it comes to this scene, they decided to parallel the original movie closely enough that I was able to do a side-by-side edit of the two. You be the judge of which is the better version.
Well, monsieur shall have the dessert after all. Mousse au chocolat, or as many calls it, chocolate mouse.
What is this?
He called it a plaisir d'amour. Mispronounced, of course.
Has an undertaste. A chalky undertaste.
Curious undertaste.
Come on, the old bat slaved all day, now eat it.
You have no idea what I went through once I said I'd take it.
We'd like to give you a brief supper.
Dizzy.
Ooh, it's got quite a kick to it.
Yes, she turns into a giant black bird. Aside from a bird messing with Simon Peter earlier in the movie, there is not a lot of context for her sudden bird metamorphosis. I'm guessing that the costumers for the similarly timed Satan Slave or the Grim Reaper had rented out all of the demon costumes in Hollywood. Who knows? I'm leaving out a lot, but in the end, Guy tries to run everyone over with his car. She clearly does not want to be hit by that car. Guy dies, and the cops are pretty sure Andrew is responsible for this entire mess. So we conclude Andrew's story with his dynamic escape from the police as he skips off into the night. Still skipping. Still skipping. And that is literally the last we see of him. That's it. So while we are demanded by the filmmakers to look what's happened to Rosemary's baby, they repay us with, we have no idea. What becomes of a failed Antichrist? This movie never answers this question. That the filmmakers broke this most basic contract with their audience by demanding that we look, but then not presenting us with what's happened to Rosemary's baby, is perhaps, beyond even possessed mimes and demonic bird ladies, the greatest sin of all. Thank you.